LA this week.
These workers demanding higher wages and union rights on the death anniversary of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I'm Gil Reyes in downtown with a story.
I'm Anna Margos, an LA firefighter shot in the carotid artery during the Rodney King riots, but he survived. His harrowing story 25 years later.
I'm Rasha Goel. Up next, an opportunity to walk through some of downtown LA's treasures.
Hello and welcome to LA This Week. Thanks for joining us. I'm Yana Kay. Most of us will never forget the experience of watching our City of Angels burning in the wake of the civil unrest of 1992. Now, on the 25th anniversary of the riots, one LA firefighter remembers his close brush with death. Anna Margos has the story.
The first day of the Rodney King riots, 1992. A South LA crowd riled up after four LAPD officers were found not guilty in the beating of African-American parolee Rodney King. One LA firefighter crew was on its way to putting out the fires, exploding all over the city.
Driving down the 110 freeway, we could see just multiple columns of smoke and buildings on fire.
Then the unthinkable happened as a driver approached the fire truck.
The car zoomed up, put his hand out, pulled the trigger of a gun, so then I said, Scott's been shot.
The bullet came across, followed across my jawbone, went into my neck, and severed my carotid artery. When it severed my carotid artery, I had a stroke, and I was paralyzed at that point.
The quick thinking and first aid skills of his crew got Captain Scott Miller to the hospital in time to save him. But this was the first of many hard lessons for firefighters in the coming days.
We received bottles and rocks that were thrown at the engine. For the first time in my career, I thought, well, I wonder if this person's going to shoot us. We no longer carry equipment on the outside of our fire engines. And I know of one example where they used the pick head of the axe and actually used it and hit the top of a battalion command vehicle. And it went through the roof of the car.
It could have killed someone.
It could have.
Captain Miller was hospitalized for weeks and was in physical therapy for 2.5 years. When he returned to work 6 months later, he realized he would never recover enough to get back on the front lines. Still, he considered himself lucky.
I have a grandchild that I've been able to watch grow up, and that all just is the fruits of having a good day.
Miller gets emotional as he counts the good things. He will never have full use of his left arm again, but he now works in fire prevention. And the department has made changes. Crews wear armored vests on dangerous calls. They've changed their engine formations, and engine cabs are now covered. This is one battle-hardened fire department that's better prepared if civil unrest ever occurs again. I'm Anna Margos for LA This Week.
By the way, the suspect who shot Captain Miller was caught and sent to jail. Turning now to workers' wages. Could you survive on $10.50 an hour? Well, that's the current minimum wage in LA. And though raises are coming, workers who handle our food say they're not happening fast enough. Gil Reyes has more.
Fast food workers march through downtown, demanding higher pay.
From places to McDonald's, Burger King, El Pollo Loco, anything you can think of, fast food basically.
The workers demanding a $15 an hour minimum wage. They'll get their wish, but it will have to happen slowly over a period of years. Local leaders have set up a gradual wage increase every July to cushion the blow for employers.
The gradual increase to the $15 an hour minimum wage has already started, expected to kick in here in Los Angeles in 2020, statewide in 2022. But these workers say that's too far away.
No, it's not good enough. We need 15 now.
I mean, you have a family. How are you going to take care of your children? How are you going to get healthcare, things of that nature? So yes, $15 an hour. We need more than $15 an hour. But right now, we'll fight for the $15 an hour and try to go forward.
The march from downtown's financial district to Skid Row coincided with the anniversary of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s assassination. Dr. King had been demonstrating with black sanitation workers for better wages when he was killed. Like those workers in 1968, these fast food workers also want the right to unionize.
To this day, we don't have 2017. Over 50% of black workers do not have $15 of minimum wage, and over 60% of Latino workers don't have $15 the hour.
The $15 wage will happen, but for workers struggling to get by, how long can they wait? In downtown LA, I'm Gil Reyes for LA This Week.
LA's minimum wage jumps to $12 an hour in July. The wage will go up every summer until it reaches $15 an hour in 2020. An update now on the Crenshaw LAX rail line. Crews have added a new rail crossing at Centinela and Florence as the project inches ever closer to completion. However, people affected by construction raised concerns at a recent meeting. Gil Reyes has more.
Construction of Metro's Crenshaw LAX line is causing problems for Marie Bryant and other drivers.
People who are living on some of the side streets, they are coming home late in the afternoon and they are trying to find place for parking. I can only imagine what's going to happen when the train comes through.
Metro officials say parking and other traffic problems related to construction are expected. But will there be enough parking when it's finished? Bryant and others gathered at this community meeting hope so. The Crenshaw LAX line will stretch 8.5 miles and will serve the Crenshaw District, Inglewood, and Westchester. It's billed as an alternative to driving on LA's congested streets. Teachers at View Park Preparatory School support it.
When Metro approached us, we said we're all in because, believe it or not, you know, our students are ultimately going to be using the Metro to get to school.
But finding parking remains on Marie Bryant's mind.
I'm really excited about the train. Don't get me wrong. I really am. I've always been supportive of that. I think it's something that's needed. But I still have to stress. I know you're channel 35, you said, and it's a city channel. I'm hoping this will get back to our city elected officials.
In Leimert Park, I'm Gil Reyes for LA This Week.
The Crenshaw LAX line is expected to be completed in 2019. Over at City Hall, it was a day meant for celebration and recognition. But this year's Trans Day of Visibility served as a reminder that many transgender people feel far from safe in our country. Anna Marcos takes a look.
They pray for things that most of us have never had to pray for.
Strengthen us and keep us and help us. Oh God, there are forces high and low, and some see themselves as mighty, who would destroy us, who would continue to perpetuate the environment that leads to our murder.
These are the leaders of LA's transgender community. On this Trans Day of Visibility, they stand with city leaders and some of the LAPD's LGBT officers. Together, they're speaking up for the most vulnerable, like the 8 trans women murdered in hate crimes countrywide in the last 3 months alone.
China Gibson was killed on February 25th in New Orleans.
Jamie Lee Wounded Arrow killed on January 1st in Sioux Falls, South Dakota.
Misha Caldwell killed on January 4th in Canton, Mississippi.
But today is also a day for being counted, for becoming visible to the world, and for fighting injustice in an unfriendly political climate.
Recently, we learned that Donald Trump eliminated sexual orientation identity from the 2020 census, denying us the funding for critical support services.
I identify as a transgender man. My pronouns are he, him, his, and that's how I like to be recognized.
This is not a day of mourning. This is a day of visibility. This is a day of recognition. This is a day of empowerment.
These activists are part of LA's Transgender Advisory Council, one of the first permanent transgender councils in the country. And they advise city leaders on HIV and health care, job and housing discrimination, and other issues that affect the transgender community.
The primary scary experience that I have faced has not been one of violence,
but one where I have not been protected on my job. And so when a corporation found out that I was a trans woman, I was instantly terminated.
Oftentimes, we are left out of the conversation and we are not at the table when decisions are being made on our behalf.
These things all add to almost erasing our humanity.
I hope this nightmare will be over soon and we can all achieve our constitutional and God-given right for life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. Thank you.
For these activists, those rights have to start with speaking your truth. I'm Anna Marcos for LA This Week.
The Trans Day of Visibility is honored in countries around the world. Well, for many of us, the weekend may be a time for some R&R, but not for one community. Hyde Park residents and fellow Angelenos came out to get their hands dirty for a clean cause. Rasha Goel has more.
Rakes, brooms, shovels, and some helping hands were all on board to help clean up the Hyde Park neighborhood.
We will be going up and down Hyde Park Boulevard between 11th Avenue and Van Ness Avenue, cleaning up all of the weeds, bulky items, trash, any issues that we have on the railroad tracks.
It's an area the district has received a lot of complaints about. In addition to beautifying the area, it's also a chance to interact with neighbors.
What we're trying to do is give people an opportunity to meet each other, to work shoulder to shoulder, to get to see your neighborhood. It's very different than driving through your neighborhood than it is walking block to block.
Various community groups also came out to help.
It's something that we have to do as a community, try to make our city as beautiful as possible with the help of the youth.
No job at this cleanup is too small. Little by little, but large enough to make an impact. I'm Rasha Goel for LA This Week.
Think it's too late to earn a high school diploma? Well, think again. The LA City Library offers free accredited classes online for working adults. Gil Reyes has more from a different kind of graduation ceremony.
She finally did it. After dropping out of high school years ago, Valeria Siriani took advantage of a second chance and finally earned her high school diploma.
It was something really amazing. It was like a whole new experience.
Congratulations go out to 30 unique graduating students. Their ages range between 20 and 55, the latest to graduate from the LA City Library's Career Online High School program. It allows people who, for some reason or another, didn't finish traditional high school to finally earn their diplomas at their own time. And oftentimes in between work. Take the case of class valedictorian and library employee Samson Rodriguez, feeling out of place in traditional high school after immigrating from Mexico. He too had dropped out years ago.
There was a lot of pressure and there was humiliation too when I would get called out or bullied at a young age for not knowing certain simple things. So I like Career Online High School because it was simple. I did it from home.
Graduate Claudine Verdier discovered her high school credits in her native Belize could not transfer over to the U.S. So she too enrolled in the program and is now trying to convince her son, a dropout, to do the same.
I just say, I'm just going to do the whole high school over. And I showed him, I could do it, you could do it.
The LA City Library is the first library system in the nation to offer these courses.
It's an incredible program and a great example of how the library really changes lives. These individuals now with their high school diploma are able to get better jobs and more opportunities in higher education.
So I'm currently in school, I'm getting my bachelor's, and I'm going to be going to chiropractic school too as soon as I'm done.
Nice.
I go to Pasadena City College. Yeah, I'm working for my associates for nursing.
If you think you're scared, or you think it's too hard, or you think it's not right for you, just do it. I mean, what do you have to lose?
Nothing, of course, because online classes are free. At Career Online High School Graduation, I'm Gil Reyes for LA This Week.
Interested in enrolling? Well, check out the website lapl.org/COHS. Well, it's a reminder of the lessons learned from the Rodney King riots. 25 years later, art helps us to give us perspective as the Reimagined Justice exhibit opens in South LA.
Night begins to fall and the intersection is burning. Another man who was beaten staggers up as a black preacher seems to pray over him.
The Rodney King riots marked their 25th anniversary this month, and the Office of Community Coalition, a social justice group formed after the riots, has turned its entire office into a living art exhibit for the month. It sits less than a mile from where the riots started in South LA. The reimagined justice exhibit focuses on the civil unrest and looting, which started after LAPD officers were found not guilty in the beating of Rodney King. The riots then spread to other parts of the city.
It really marks a time for us to take a moment to pause and really think about and reflect around, you know, what has really changed 25 years later. Learn about the roots that led up to the civil unrest. Also talk about what are some of the conditions that folks are facing today.
Photographs, art, live performances, and media all give a glimpse into different people's experiences of the riots. Over 50 artists and their teams are taking part, and many of them are from South LA.
It was really powerful in putting this show together, how many people came who brought their personal artifacts, people's original photographs that have never been seen before.
Among those never-before-seen photos is the work of photographer Abraham Torres.
That night, we didn't realize that we're driving into the riot. The riot had begun that night. These pictures are incredibly rare.
The future of our city really depends on how much progress we can bring to communities like South Los Angeles that have a history of neglect and disinvestment.
There's a way of being cathartic about the experience because everybody who was in LA during that time knows exactly where they were during the riots and has a story to tell.
And the exhibits allow plenty of room for both catharsis and reflection on how we can bring progress to a long impoverished area. I'm Anna Marcos for LA This Week.
For more information, visit cocosouthla.org/LA Uprising. Police and firefighters shave it all off to raise money for cancer research. Gil Reyes shows us what all the buzz is about on St. Baldrick's Day.
A nice full head of hair on both LA City Fire Captain Danny Wu and LAPD Lieutenant Greg Doyle, but not for long. And it's all for a good cause.
15 years ago, when my son had cancer, I joined up with the fire department. The captain at this station was doing an event, and he let me join in very graciously. And ever since then, it's taken off. So over the years, we've raised over $1 million for the St. Baldrick's Foundation.
The yearly St. Baldrick's Day event at North Hollywood Fire Station raises money for child cancer research. People shave their heads in solidarity, a show of support for loved ones who bravely endured pain and loss of hair from chemotherapy. Maggie Ownby lost a family member to cancer in February.
I did this for Eileen and her memory and her loving memory, and I'm doing it also for the honored kids. I met a wonderful kid today named Angel, and it just touched my heart so much.
This year our goal is $100,000, and we're pretty confident we're going to reach that. But just to be sure, I encouraged everybody to get out here this morning and to help us reach our goal.
Every 3 minutes around the world, a child is diagnosed with cancer. People gladly losing their locks in hopes of one day finding a cure. In North Hollywood, I'm Gil Reyes for LA This Week.
Officials at the fire department say they surpassed their $100,000 fundraising goal. Well, plenty of hair was also being cut over at a Woodland Hill school as kids cut their ponytails for cancer victims. Anna Marcos has more from the annual Pony Up Cut-A-Thon.
Lots and lots of ponytails everywhere. There's blonde ones, long ones, there's twin ponytails, multiple ponytails, and more, as dozens of students, even parents and teachers, prep their hair for the 4th annual Pony Up Cut-A-Thon.
I'm going to miss it probably for the first minute, and then I'll probably get over it.
I'm cutting my hair. I want to give them to the person who don't have any hair.
One of my family members has cancer, and they're fighting it right now. So I feel bad.
Well, I want them to feel happy that they don't feel out like they don't have hair. So I want to give them my hair so they feel happy.
The Cut-A-Thon at Serenia Charter Elementary School in Woodland Hills helps collect hair for cancer survivors who have lost their hair after going through chemotherapy. Yvette Peterson, a two-time cancer survivor, started the event.
When you look into the mirror and see yourself bald, it's such a significant reminder that you're sick and you don't feel whole. What's really powerful about that is not just the hair that people are cutting off so it can be made into a wig, but that tremendous act of kindness.
A snip of the scissors and there they go, donating anywhere from 8 inches to a foot of their hair. It takes hair from about 6 volunteers to make a wig.
I feel so good.
Well, I thought about it, but I wasn't quite brave enough to cut my hair. However, I am lending support with a little pony up beanie.
Oh my, there's even some styling going on. Now I really wish I would have done it. This little boy did. I'm Anna Marcos for LA This Week.
By the way, you can cut your hair and donate it to the cause anytime. To find out how, visit Pantene.com and click on the link Beautiful Lengths. A Dudley intersection in West Hills gets a safety upgrade. Councilmember Mitch Englander kicks off his film festival for young filmmakers, and kids in West LA have a new place to play. All these stories in Citybeat. Councilmember Mitchell Englander joined Los Angeles Department of Transportation and community members to activate a pedestrian warning device at the Jason and Roscoe intersection in West Hills. The project's undertaking comes after a mother, her daughter, and their family dog were struck and killed while crossing the street in the marked but uncontrolled crosswalk. Officials say the Jason and Roscoe Pedestrian Warning Device Project combines two overhead flashing beacons with pedestrian controls and in-road flashing LEDs to vastly improve visibility of those crossing the intersection, especially at night. Englander also kicked off his second annual Movies That Matter Youth Short Film Festival, which is open to young filmmakers from elementary, middle, high school, and college campuses throughout Council District 12 and the San Fernando Valley. Participants will be using the themes of social action and civic engagement to channel their creative process in one of four categories: public service announcement, documentary, live action, and animation. For more information or to submit, visit cd12movies.com. The Department of Recreation and Parks, along with Councilmember Paul Corrette, celebrated the reopening of the playground at Cheviot Hills Recreation Center, located in West LA. Cheviot Hills Park serves nearly 6,000 residents who are within walking distance. The newly installed playground was designed with a treehouse-themed play area featuring a hollowed-out sycamore tree piece with multiple stumps that children can play on. The play equipment includes 2 bays of swings, 2 belts, and 2 tot seats, and a tire swing.
For more fun, you know, more up-to-date, and I think this will be a great place for kids.
Well, you probably think you've seen all there is to see in LA, right? Well, you'd be wrong. A new experience is highlighting some of LA's hidden gems while making the old look new again. Rasha Goel has more as the Center Theater Group recently celebrated its 50th anniversary.
It's an opportunity to explore the sights and sounds of downtown LA. Remote LA, put on by the Center Theater Group, is celebrating its 50th season at the Mark Taper Forum. This walking performance tour gives people a unique way to learn about themselves, people around them, and the city.
You walk next to others, but how close do you want them to be? How close do you want to be to your neighbor?
Remote LA isn't your average tour. Through a computer-generated recording, you are guided through the city in real time, and not just as a spectator, but also as a participant. The performance reveals an unseen LA, places where people explore their limits and see common places. It's a creative way of seeing the city while understanding how you perceive things.
I thought it might be a great way to see places that I don't usually have access to in the city, and to do so with other people, meet new people, interact with them, and new spaces at the same time.
I know LA fairly well, and I've lived in the area for a long time, but it just seemed a really unusual way to encounter downtown.
From the inside of Union Station to the outside of Pershing Square, visitors are able to capture the historic sights of downtown LA without a detailed narrative.
downstairs, walk along the platform. Don't enter any train before I tell you to do so.
I feel like everyone kind of has an idea of what LA is, so maybe this will give like a new perspective.
A new way of seeing an old city. In downtown Los Angeles, I'm Rasha Goel for LA This Week.
Center Theater Group is one of LA's leading nonprofit theater companies. Well, if you love modern art, you may want to check out the new exhibit at Art in Practice. Enjoy an Earth Day celebration that's perfect for the whole family. And some seniors go all out for a talent show in Sherman Oaks. All this in this week's Things to Do. Art in Practice presents a solo exhibition of artworks by artist Al Loving. For 40 years, Loving experimented with materials and process to expand the definition of modern painting, drawing on everything from free jazz to his family's quilting tradition. In the 1980s, Loving broke free of that flat image, using heavy rag paper to make three-dimensional collages in brilliant colors. At AMP, Spiral Play will feature 12 of these collages, some of them monumental in scale. The work is radical, beautiful, and deeply human. His work will be on display at Art and Practice at 3401 West 43rd Place in Leimert Park from April 22nd through July 29th. To learn more, visit artandpractice.org. Join LA Sanitation for the annual Citywide LA Sanitation Earth Day LA 2017 Festival. There will be over 50 exhibits dedicated to promoting sustainability and environmentally friendly activities, including city vehicles to explore, seed planting, and mulch giveaways. Entertainment will also be on hand, including performances from Tommy the Clown and other musical acts. The event takes place Saturday, April 22nd at Exposition Park, South Lawn, near the Metro Expo Line. For more, visit lacitysan.org. Unleash your artistic talents during the Spring 2017 Senior Amateur Talent Show. Join the fun or just come watch a variety of individual and group performances of singing, dancing, spoken word, and comedy. If you've ever wanted to show off your talents, this is the perfect opportunity. Admission is free and all ages are welcome. It all takes place at the Sherman Oaks East Valley Adult Center at 5056 Van Nuys Boulevard. For more information, call 818-386-9674. And that's a look at some things to do. Well, that's going to do it for this edition. I'm Yana Kane from all of us here at LA This Week. Thanks for joining us. A reminder that you can catch us online at lacityview.org. You can also follow and like us on Facebook. We'll see you back here next week for more of LA This Week.